traveled very far when suddenly I saw three small ships a-sailing off towards a distant shore. Lighting up a cigarette, I followed in pursuit and found a secret cave where they obviously stay salute. Filling up my pockets, even stuffed it up my nose. I must have weighed 100 tons between my head and toes. I ventured forth before the dawn had time to change its mind. Sailing high above the clouds, I found a golden shrine.
City, at least, has become the subject of a major experiment.
Last summer, Atlanta's mayor, Maynard Jackson, called this $400 million expansion program to a halt. He insisted there be no more designing and no more engineering until all equal employment opportunity standards had been met. But Jackson just wasn't talking about jobs for blacks. He was demanding they get a shot at the profits white firms were getting for the actual designing and building of the nation's second busiest airport. The airlines were footing the bill for the bulk of the expansion, but federal money was being used, and the airport is owned by the city. These two factors gave Jackson his basis for stopping the project short.
And we think that our policy attends a broader scale than simply hiring, and it also means a sharing in the economic pie, so to speak, by people who can qualify, who can cut the mustard.
The ultimatum from the mayor was called Joint Venture for Affirmative Action. Jackson explained that for the past 50 years, white firms had been teaming up, sharing their expertise, and winning the bids to build the city. Now he decided Joint Venture would be a way for blacks, who comprise 51% of the population, to win city contracts too. The engineers and architects who won the original airport contracts agreed to the mayor's proposal. Both brought in minority firms to make up their joint ventures and promote black involvement.
I guess everybody has to learn, and we had been doing it in another way. We had been considering the health of the community for many years in our minority hiring and training program. I guess it just really never occurred to us that another way was available. But it was shown to us as an option, and we welcomed the chance to do it.
But the mayor's new policy was not put through without a fight. The opposition, politicians, businessmen, and voters argued that delaying the airport project meant a loss of time and money.
We are dealing in government contracting with the public's money. No matter how you slice it, in some way or form, it's the government, it's the public's money. And I do not think that we should talk about spending more money than is necessary just to have a joint venture.
There's a lot riding on this project. Other cities, government agencies, and private business will be watching closely the progress at Atlanta's Hartsfield International Airport. They'll be looking to see if joint venture for affirmative action really can work, if it can ensure the profits of those already in the economic mainstream and make room for those who are still trying to get in. Jackie Castleberry, CBS News,
Atlanta. You may recall
that
earlier this year, it was reported that violent crime had gone up in eight cities the Nixon administration had targeted in a multi-million dollar anti-crime program. And a, quote, severe crime rate increase was reported in Atlanta for the years studied, 1968 to 1974. CBS News correspondent Bernard Goldberg has done a follow-up story, including a look into who suffered most in Atlanta's crime wave.
Six out of every 10 Atlantans are black. But almost all of the city's crime, 80%, is committed by blacks against blacks. Black-on-black crime, which blacks once considered too sensitive to speak about openly, now has become a major public issue.
A crook is a crook is a crook. And because a crook is black, even though black people are racially and economically oppressed, does not give that person an excuse for preying on the black community. In this country, if one is black, the chances one will be robbed are five times greater than if one is white. A black poor woman's chances of being raped are four times as high than those of a white woman. I think we've had enough. I think that there is no reason to excuse a crook regardless of color.
This is Atlanta's Model Cities area. It is 85% black. Unemployment runs high and poverty is a way of life. It is one of Atlanta's roughest neighborhoods where virtually all crime is black on black. In an effort to cut down on crime, police opened a station house in an abandoned pool hall in the middle of the neighborhood and began patrolling the area as if it were a small town. Police mingle with the neighborhood people and even carry business cards.
Okay, you got a card?
Yeah, okay.
I'll see y'all later.
Hold it down, okay?
And police attend community meetings.
What can we do to help them? Help y'all policing.
You won't be in trouble for reporting a crime. I think that we all realize that it's our civic responsibility and duties.
Captain Johnny Sparks is leading the crime-fighting effort in the Model Cities area. His goal, to improve confidence in the police and get people to report crime.
This community in particular felt that the police was their enemy. And I guess they rather side with the criminal element in the community rather than the police because they felt they were not getting the services from the police agency. I think we've been successful in changing that attitude.
So they're starting to talk to you now?
They're starting to talk to us.
It's still too early to tell if the public relations campaign is translating into more confidence in the police. But initial police figures indicate that at least some crimes are down, notably burglary down 33% over last year and robbery down 36%.
What we've tried to do in the last year and a half is to get people to understand that crime is colorless. And what we've been able to do is to prick their conscience to get them to understand that it's far more beneficial to everybody if we start isolating the criminal, start perceiving him as being a brother or a sister, and look at him as just a criminal. And if we look at him as just a criminal, it's much easier for us to turn that person in.
There was a time when blacks would not publicly condemn black-on-black crime, partly because they feared the police, partly because they viewed the criminal himself as a victim of poverty and racism. But now the mood is changing. More and more blacks are running out of sympathy. Bernard Goldberg, CBS News, Atlanta.
An explosion tore through a daycare center today in Atlanta's predominantly black Bowen Homes housing project. Officials say four children and an adult were killed and seven persons were hospitalized. Sam Ford was there.
There were more than 90 people inside the daycare center when the explosion ripped out the back wall, witnesses said, sending debris and children flying through the air. Catherine Osborne was preparing lunch for the children at the time.
Can you tell me what happened?
No, all I know was the wall just crashed in on me.
In the pandemonium that followed, just about every ambulance in Atlanta was dispatched to the scene. Authorities worked frantically, digging the dead and injured from the rubble as parents ran screaming in search of their children. For some, their worst fears were true.
My latest called me and told me the school had blown up down here, and I came down and there it was.
And how did you find out your little boy was a victim?
Well, I didn't want to see him. His mother went in there and she seen him.
Authorities believe the explosion was caused by gas leaking from a furnace. But this tragedy comes as Atlanta is undergoing a rash of mysterious child murders. 14 black children murdered or missing in a little more than a year. So many residents were suspicious.
Based on what our fire and police officials have told us, the only evidence we have at this time indicates that this was an accident. Just a minute. Just a minute.
Many people sat down and cried afterward, including one teacher who managed to save all the members of her class.
And all of a sudden, the building just went poof, and all I could think was just hit the door and get the children out. Just get out, children, get out, get out.
The city soon ordered the six daycare centers it runs evacuated after receiving numerous bomb threats. The mayor says all will remain closed until they can be thoroughly inspected. Sam Ford, CBS News.
25 minutes past the hour.
It isn't often that you can say of one newspaper that it helped shape the course of the nation's history. It's even less often you can say that of a small newspaper. But Sam Ford in Atlanta has a follow-up report on one small paper that's just observed its 50th anniversary and that did help shape history until history began passing it by.
The Atlanta Daily World began in August 1928. Its founder and first publisher was W.A. Scott, who died only 6 years after the newspaper opened. Since 1934, the newspaper has remained in the family and has been run by younger brother C.A. The 70-year-old Scott is a staunch Republican, a conservative, who over the years has used his editorials to criticize such people as the late Dr. Martin Luther King and more recently, UN Ambassador Andrew Young. But Scott says in the early days, the newspaper concentrated on changing the image of black people.
And I wrote more editorials for all of them because in the 30s and the 40s, we wouldn't talk about no Democrats and Republicans because we didn't have any votes anyway, hardly in the South, until 44, when the white primary was outlawed in Texas.
The world showed blacks in a positive light. It told of black accomplishments, and it kept readers informed on the struggle for equality. In the 40s, the world helped organize Atlanta's black voting power into coalitions with liberal and moderate whites, which led to much desegregation in Atlanta before the civil rights movement. Also, in the pre-civil rights days, the world provided jobs for many reporters who are today among America's most prominent black journalists. Nowadays, the world isn't what it used to be. At one time, it employed a staff of 55 pressmen who printed dozens of other black newspapers from around the country on contract in addition to the world. But now, the staff consists of a few people who type the information into a machine for an offset printing process. Since the late 60s, the World has come out only 4 days a week instead of six. And while its circulation has been declining, two black weeklies have had gains. Some critics say black Atlantans would be more supportive of the newspaper if the publisher's views weren't so conservative. But C.A. Scott, who is about to go into semi-retirement, seems at peace with himself.
I don't know of a major thing I would do differently. I even kid my wife. I said, I didn't believe I'd even marry you again. She's that's a fact.
Now, Sam Ford, CBS News, Atlanta.
These are not pleasant days on the south side of Atlanta. Someone has been abducting and murdering black children, and the police unable to make any headway are under fire. Sam Ford reports.
Insanity is how Atlanta's mayor has described it. In a little more than a year, eight Atlanta children have been found strangled, bludgeoned, or shot to death. Six others are missing. The latest victim, 12-year-old Charles Stevens, was found Friday. He had last been seen several hours earlier at a neighborhood grocery store. Police are puzzled by these killings in which all of the victims are inner-city black children, most of them boys between the ages of 8 and 15 years old. The parents of the dead and missing have formed their own group called the Committee to Stop Children's Murders. The head of the group is Camille Bell, whose 9-year-old son, Youssef, was found dead last November.
I know that every time it comes back, it comes about, it leaves me frustrated and frightened and angry all at the same time. And I know it does it to everybody else here in this city.
Since July 1979, Atlanta has been plagued by senseless crimes against children.
Atlanta television stations have run announcements looking for missing children and warning parents of the dangers, and civil rights leaders have led protest marches and rallies against the killings.
Somebody in our community has some information. Somebody knows what went down, and if we care enough, if we love enough, we'll belch it up.
State and local authorities have formed a 20-man task force, but the Atlanta Police Department, under heavy criticism from the press, is on the defensive.
We are, through the establishment of our task force, utilizing all the resources humanly possible, doing all that's humanly possible to solve the cases. To ask why haven't we is a rhetorical question, because if we could have, we would have.
$20,000 in rewards have been offered for information leading to the arrest of the killer or killers. But authorities have little confidence that the rewards can be paid before another innocent child dies. Sam Ford, CBS News, Atlanta.
In Atlanta, the problem isn't how to get around, it's how to get around safely. Sam Ford reports.
Atlanta is by nature a booster town where people relish the idea of being the New York of the South. But what they don't have in mind is the big city crime rate. Indeed, Atlanta's homicide rate is now worse than New York's. And the press has dubbed the city the murder capital of America, an image city, state, and business leaders here in the South's principal convention center have been working hard to shake. The state has sent in Georgia troopers to handle many traffic duties so the understaffed Atlanta Police Department can step up its fight against crime. The department has formed what it calls the Flying Squad, which concentrates on high crime areas during peak crime periods of the day. But at least part of the police department's problems may stem from being perceived by some of the public as weak.
If I wanted to go up and rob a store or something, I could get away with it because there wouldn't be any police protection.
Why do you think you could get away with it?
I just feel that I could because the police are never in the right place at the right time.
Police have stepped up arrests in areas where prostitutes work and in downtown parks where people sometimes drink and smoke pot openly. The police consider these areas breeding grounds for serious crime. For his part, Atlanta Mayor Maynard Jackson has gone on citywide television outlining his anti-homicide program. He has even scheduled a mass meeting for ministers, priests, and rabbis this week to seek ways of cutting domestic homicides, which account for more than half of the total. And the mayor has a new special advisor on crime, just back home from Washington.
We're going to have to put plenty of policemen on the street. We're going to have to follow the cases through the court to be certain that the courts are not turning people out that shouldn't be turned out. And we're going to have to face the fact that there are some bad people in our society. And if they're bad people, then the bad people have to be locked up.
Although one conventioneer was killed recently after refusing to give his money to a mugger, many tourists are not very concerned about the crime.
Went out last night, had a good time, so didn't bother me. I stopped and asked a police officer, what the safest place to go. And he said, there's not a safe place. Just stay in your hotel. But I went anyway.
One who resents such statements by police is the man in charge of the police department, who also complains about reporters from other high-crime cities who called to question him about Atlanta's homicides.
If they want to talk about crime, look at their own neighborhood. Of course we have a problem. Anytime we have a 29% increase in crime, it's a problem. Anytime we have crime, it's a problem. But again, the unique aspect of Atlanta is that we're aggressively addressing the problem. We intend to turn our crime problem around.
Earlier this year, the bank robbery rate was a big problem, but after a concentrated push by local authorities and the FBI, the frequency of bank robberies declined significantly. The city's hope is that the current anti-homicide campaign will have a similar effect. Sam Ford, CBS News,
Fresno, California.
Between July 1979 and last May, 28 Atlanta blacks were murdered and one disappeared. Today, the only person charged in any of those bizarre crimes entered a plea during a brief Atlanta courtroom appearance. Sam Ford was there.
This morning, after waiting television crews were searched, 23-year-old Wayne Williams was led from his isolation cell at the Fulton County Jail for the 10-minute ride downtown, this time for his arraignment. It was 1 month ago today that the freelance TV cameraman was indicted for the murders of 28-year-old Nathaniel Cater and 21-year-old Jimmy Ray Payne, two of the most recent victims in the 28 Atlanta murders. In a packed courtroom where all spectators had been searched, a heavily guarded Williams rose before Judge Clarence Cooper and in a confident voice said, "I plead not guilty to both counts." Judge Cooper set a tentative trial date of October 5th. He then issued a stern warning to all attorneys against making statements to the media. The entire proceeding lasted only 10 minutes. Williams' parents were silent as they left the building after the arraignment. Also at the courthouse today was Alonzo Cater, father of victim Nathaniel Cater. He had no comment. Williams' attorney, Mary Welcome, would like to see the two murder cases tried separately. Judge Cooper says he will hear all attorney motions a month before the trial begins. Attorney Mary Welcome is predicting a long trial, saying it could extend from October into 1982. And the prosecutor says even if Williams is convicted, under Georgia law, he cannot seek the death penalty, since there is no indication that the victims were tortured before they were killed. Sam Ford, CBS News.
Industry.
In an Atlanta courtroom yesterday, testimony began in one of the most widely publicized murder trials in recent times. And as Sam Ford reports, the defense began aggressively.
Wayne Bertram Williams, age 23, has been in jail more than 6 months now. And all the public knows is that microscopic fiber evidence supposedly links him to most of the 28 Atlanta murder victims. Testimony in his trial for two of those murders began yesterday, focusing first on 21-year-old Jimmy Ray Payne, a drifter and ex-con whose body was pulled from the Chattahoochee River last April 27th. He was clad only in swimming trunks. The defense spent much of its time questioning whether Payne was murdered or had accidentally drowned. Defense attorney Alvin Binder put medical examiner Saleh Zaki under grueling cross-examination, forcing Zaki to admit he could not say with absolute certainty that Payne had not drowned. But Zaki told the 9-woman, 3-man jury that Payne's death had come during the height of the youth murder crisis and was similar to many others. Binder also attacked Zaki for changing Payne's death certificate from death by an undetermined manner before Williams was indicted to death by homicide 3 weeks after the indictment. Zaki has said previously he mistakenly checked the wrong box on the first death certificate. The defense attorney next took on Atlanta Public Safety Commissioner Lee Brown, accusing him of being railroaded into including Payne among the murdered. Binder: Commissioner Brown, just as sure as you're sitting there twiddling your thumbs, didn't you tell the press of this community you weren't going to put him on the task force list? Brown denied making any such statement. The district attorney has described the state's case against Wayne Williams as akin to a jigsaw puzzle. He told the jury that at the conclusion, there would be enough pieces to the puzzle that they'd be able to see the picture. Obviously, at this point, there are many pieces missing. Sam Ford, CBS News, Atlanta.
In a California court yesterday, a decision in a case that has attracted nationwide attention. David Dow has the report.
Reactions and mixed emotions. Those were the feelings among some of the parents of the Atlanta victims today. Sam Ford spoke to one who felt a mother-to-mother compassion, the compassion of a victim's mother to the mother of Wayne Williams, compassion in spite of her grief over the murder of her son.
I don't know, Lord. I don't know. I really don't know. I just wish he'd come on home to me.
Assie Lee Jeter a year ago after her 14-year-old son, Luby Jr., disappeared. She later had to go identify him, another victim of the Atlanta tragedy. Mrs. Jeter was among the mothers who regularly attended the Wayne Williams trial, where two witnesses testified they saw her son with Williams the afternoon he disappeared. Today, Mrs. Jeter said although she agreed with the verdict, it saddened her.
I felt for the family because I'm a mother too, because I know she took it pretty hard.
Mrs. Williams.
Yes, and I understand, but see, I'm lost a baby, and I really have the feeling that he did it.
This morning, Mrs. Jeter attended 11 o'clock services at her church, where last February she attended her son's funeral. And like many Atlanta pastors this morning, the Reverend George Baker spoke of the verdict.
Now the trial is over. 8 women's and 4 men gave the verdict that Mr. William was guilty.
If it hadn't have been for that young man, maybe my son could have been able to come to be a good church worker too, like all the other young men.
During the height of the murder crisis, many congregations, including the one Mrs. Jeter belongs to, prayed for the killer to be caught. Today they pray that the city's nightmare is forever over. Sam Ford, CBS News, Atlanta.
In Atlanta, it's the day after. One day after the jury found Wayne Williams guilty as charged, guilty of 2 of that city's series of killings of young people. Williams still says he didn't do it. His lawyers say they are looking ahead to possible appeals. But some investigators say Williams is not only responsible for the killings brought up at the trial, they say he's linked to almost all the murders, including one which was never included on the official list of victims. Ned Potter reports.
Wayne Williams, investigators say, is the explanation for virtually all of Atlanta's trauma. He was convicted of 2 murders, and in court evidence was introduced linking him with 10 others. But some authorities tell the Atlanta Journal they believe he was the killer of 27. Prosecutor Lewis Slayton will not go that far, but he calls Williams the main killer.
The killings were happening at a rapid pace. They abruptly stopped.
As in the 2 cases on which convictions were returned, fibers were key to many of the others. Fibers from Williams' home, cars, or pet were reportedly found on 21 of the 28 victims. 5 other cases are similar enough, say police, to be linked also.
In addition, authorities say fibers were found on the body of a 28-year-old man, John Harold Porter, who was never added to the list. So in the final analysis, only the cases of the 2 little girls, Angel Lanier and Latonya Wilson, continue without leads.
Atlanta's a great city which has lived through a nightmare.
In Buffalo, New York last night for a scholarship foundation dinner, former Atlanta Mayor Maynard Jackson said his city was stronger now.
We trust now that matter is behind us.
From the beginning to the verdict, Atlanta's homicide task force spent $3 million looking for clues. Today, officials said it would likely be closed down soon. Ned Potter, CBS News.
This is a CBS News special report. Verdict in Atlanta. Here is CBS News correspondent Dan Rather.
Good evening. The verdict tonight, guilty. And to the end, Wayne Williams said he did not do it, did not kill any of 28 young Atlantans. But the jury found otherwise, that he did kill at least 2 of them, Jimmy Ray Payne and Nathaniel Cater, the 2 he was formally charged with killing. The sentence imposed immediately, 2 consecutive life terms. Parole, technically possible after serving 14 years. For now, it's the end of a chilling chapter that Americans came to know as the Atlanta murders, a chapter that had begun quietly in July of 1979. There were few headlines then. Some said it was because, sadly, so many children turn up missing for so many reasons. Others said it was because the victims were poor and black. Either way, 14-year-old Edward Smith and 13-year-old Alfred Evans were the first known victims, both found dead July 28, 1979. More victims would follow over the next 22 months. Slowly, the realization and the headlines. Someone was killing the black children of Atlanta. Someone with more street savvy than the street smart victims. That someone, said the prosecution, was 23-year-old Wayne B. Williams, himself a black man. And tonight, a jury of 8 blacks and 4 whites agreed. Bruce Hall is in Atlanta.
It was late afternoon when the jury sent out a note from the courtroom to Judge Clarence Cooper, saying they had reached a verdict in one case, but not in the other. Judge Cooper told them they must have verdicts in both cases. 2 hours later, they did, and the call went out to enter the courtroom. Judge Cooper told foreperson Sandra Laney to give the verdict to District Attorney Lewis Layton, who walked to the podium and in a quiet, monotone voice read, "We, the jury, find the defendant Wayne Williams guilty on count 1, the killing of Nathaniel Cater. Count 2, guilty of the killing of Jimmy Ray Payne." There was no reaction from Wayne Williams. Judge Cooper called the 23-year-old music promoter and his father to the podium. They were surrounded by deputies. The elder Williams, barely able to control his rage, told the court, "I don't see how anybody, anywhere, could find my son guilty. I think that it's very unfair." Judge Cooper asked Wayne Williams if he had anything to say before he passed sentence. Williams once again said he was innocent. Judge Cooper then sentenced him to 2 consecutive life terms in prison. Under tight security, Wayne Williams was whisked away from the courthouse and driven to the Fulton County Jail. Williams, looking very depressed, was surrounded by deputies. Williams will remain in this jail until after the appeals are filed. The prosecuting team was elated with the verdict, saying they were confident all along that Williams was their man.
All of this time we were working on the case, we were trying to exclude Wayne Williams. We could not exclude Wayne Williams. We kept getting evidence that included Wayne Williams.
I think that it's probably the greatest fiber case ever tried, and it's probably going to advance scientific evidence in criminal trials in America more so than any case in this century.
Defense attorney Alvin Binder conceded the fibers were a key element.
I think the fiber evidence was the hardest evidence to overcome.
Do you think that his performance on the second day under cross-examination by Jack Mallard hurt him at all?
Well, the press seemed to think so. If he'd have been white, it wouldn't have hurt him.
Was race an issue?
It was there.
What was it about the testimony that you think was the most compelling?
Quite frankly, I don't know. I think it's not, I don't think it was in the court. I don't think it was in the court. I think it was the things that preceded the trial. The pressure, it's very difficult to make a decision in a situation where there have been so many deaths.
The jurors said it was a hard 9 weeks, not only on them, but also on the law enforcement officials.
You guys were super to us. All right. We thank you a lot here. It's as tough for these people as it was for us.
How do you feel?
I'm tired.
How tough was it? Do you feel confident in the decision you made?
Exactly. At the Williams home, the elder Mr. Williams was still angry.
Political pressure.
From whom?
From whom? From the federal government.
To do what?
To arrest Wayne.
Because why?
Because they wanted to cover up for the city of Atlanta, for the missing murdered children. They want, it's a cover-up. It's a scapegoat. They've used him as a scapegoat.
Police sources tonight say there are plans to bring additional charges against Williams. So in the event the verdict is overturned on appeal, they will be able to keep him in jail. There is concern that if he were to be released and allowed back on the streets of Atlanta, he might be killed. And there is now the perception in Atlanta tonight that Wayne Williams is definitely the child killer that terrorized the city for 2 years. This is Bruce Hall.
From the day he became a suspect through the trial that made him a defendant, we saw him mainly in brief glimpses and mostly through the eyes and testimony of others. Wayne B. Williams, in his early 20s, affable, placid, and pleasant, said some. A child corrupting Jekyll and Hyde, suggested others. A media man by trade, a dabbler in radio and television and musical talent promotion, a financial master of none of those trades. The mystery of Wayne Williams was not solved when he took the witness stand. There was the polite Wayne Williams, who said he killed no one. Then there was the furious Wayne Williams, who called his prosecutors fools, who, he said, failed to prove their case. David Culhane takes a look now at Wayne Williams.
There are a lot of things that went on that I feel you people in the public should know. They said something was dropped in the river, and let me say this now. I told them that I dropped nothing in the river. They said that. I didn't.
It is the voice of Wayne Williams before he was arrested last spring.
It just looks like to me you may have a bunch of murders out here. I did not do it.
It is the same voice that the jury listened to for 3 days at the end of his trial. Was he a psychopathic murderer or simply an eccentric young man caught up in the urgent effort to halt an epidemic of killing? According to Professor Abraham Ordover of Emory University in Atlanta, the testimony of Wayne Williams was crucial to the jury's decision. Professor Ordover is an expert on trial law. At the request of CBS News, he analyzed Wayne Williams' appearance in court and the tactics of the prosecution and defense lawyers. Professor Ordover said that the lack of direct evidence, fingerprints, or witnesses made the work of the jury much tougher.
It's enormously difficult. There are very few cases like this, a handful in the last 50 or 75 years. Have been tried where we had nothing but circumstantial evidence. There's usually some direct evidence in a case and a host of circumstantial evidence.
And Professor Ordover thinks that the appearance of Williams on the witness stand was the decisive factor in the trial.
When the defendant comes on, here is a person they can turn all of their attention to. They are there, that jury is there to decide the credibility of witnesses. And this is the most important witness in the trial.
He was composed and sat with his fingers laced in his lap. He spoke in a soft voice. Williams, I would characterize myself as a carefree, happy-go-lucky person. Nothing ever really bothered me.
I saw a Wayne Williams who was a likable young man from a decent family with a rather normal childhood. Not without a sense of humor.
Humor like this, defense attorney Alvin Binder. Now you sure haven't been losing no weight. Has the food been all right for you? Williams with a smile. I'm under oath. As to the prosecution's theory concerning his motives, Williams answered like this. Binder, do you harbor any feeling in your heart toward members of your race or anybody? Williams. I don't have any grudge against nobody. Binder, look at the jury and you tell me whether or not you are a homosexual or have any sexual hang-ups. Williams, there ain't no way I'm no homosexual. No.
I sat across from him. I don't ever remember him turning toward the jury during the 3 days of testimony. That's startling, to say the least. Doesn't establish a rapport with those 12 people who are going to decide his fate.
On the third day of his testimony, Williams seemed to lose his composure.
Right from the beginning, it was almost shocking. Before he even said a word, you looked at the demeanor of that man on the stand, and he had sagged. Without a question being asked, this man was sullen, unhappy, tired, and angry.
Now, I've been through a lot, and I'm tired, and I'm trying to do the best I can to answer this question. He keeps asking the same thing. The question is, did I kill anybody? And I done told this man I haven't. And a few moments later, Prosecutor Jack Mallard, I'm asking you if you were programmed. Williams, no. You want the real Wayne Williams, you got him right here. and the jury decided that the real Wayne Williams was guilty.
They saw a man who was painting himself as a perfectionist, who was perfect and who was making it. But the man answering the questions was a man revealed to be flawed in terrible ways and who could not come to grips with that. Why would he lie again and again and again and again under oath in a situation where his life might be at stake?
After the verdict, Wayne Williams said this, "I maintained my innocence all along and I still do so today. I have no malice against prosecutors or jurors. I just hope the person or persons who did it would say so. Thank you." And then he was taken away. This is David Culhane.
There was never a smoking gun, no Perry Mason confrontation, no bombshell forcing acquittal. The evidence was circumstantial, and the prosecution brought Wayne Williams to trial for two of the 28 killings. During the trial, evidence was introduced suggesting Williams' involvement in 10 more of the slayings, but the trial came and went with no evidence about the other young people slain. Some of their relatives attended the trial, but had no opportunity for a day in court. Sam Ford has their story.
13-year-old Timothy Hill's body was found on March 30, 1981. Although he was one of the 28 Atlanta murder victims, he was not among those linked to Wayne Williams in the trial, so his is one of the unmentioned murders.
I think they don't forget it. They don't forget Timmy K, because they don't say nothing about it. And I think Tim K's is, he's just strong.
Public Safety Commissioner Lee Brown says his task force is still in existence, still investigating. But in January, he told the court the staff had dropped from 100 at its peak and that only 10 investigators were still working on the remaining cases.
My information is that they are downgrading the task force to the extent there's only a few people still assigned to the investigation of the remaining cases. The information I also received is that they will phase it out within the next couple of months.
Like, our children deserve a right to be investigated to the fullest to find out who's killed them, or someone to come forth with some information.
It's already dropped.
It's already dropped.
Yeah.
Half of us haven't even seen the investigators on our kids' case in 5 to 6 months.
In some cases, the children were missing more than a year before police or the citizen teams who searched these woods every weekend discovered victims in secluded spots. And often the only remains were a few bones or weather-worn bits of clothing.
But you've got to realize that some of these cases will never be tried. A conviction would not be obtained on some of the cases due to the condition of the bodies.
And in suburban DeKalb County, where five victims were found, Public Safety Director Dixon Hand admits those cases may never come to trial.
I think that as far as our particular cases are concerned, it's going to be a very, very close decision as to whether or not they will, in fact, be tried.
Closing the books on the other cases would not upset Willie Mae Mathis, even though her 11-year-old son, Jeffrey, was not mentioned in the trial.
I'll feel satisfied that he's convicted for Jeffrey, too. But they're going to tie the other ones in on him anyway. And the other parents would be satisfied, too.
but not Camille Bell, who a year and a half ago first spurred police to investigate the murder pattern after her 9-year-old son Youssef was killed. She did volunteer work for the Wayne Williams defense team because she maintains he was a scapegoat.
The illusion of guilt was created. Once that was done, they left the city of Atlanta saying, well, hey, maybe he did it, left the nation saying, well, hey, maybe he did it. And we have basically and virtually backed off from doing any investigation. And from that, we have to conclude that nobody cares if children die.
Whether Camille Bell is right or wrong, it is doubtful at this point that anyone else will be arrested for any of these murders. In the words of W.K. Perry, some of these cases will be on the books when we're gone. This is Sam Ford.
The Atlanta killings had an impact on all of us. Like it or not, the headlines were all around us. The story, a recurrent nightmare on the airwaves. But we were observers, free to turn the page or change the channel. On Atlanta's south side, there was no such choice. It was happening there. Ned Potter has the story of a community's mass tragedy and its struggle to cope with it.
Gwendolyn Coleman has been a teacher for 33 years. Try to get her to admit that she is any more careful about the children now.
Is your mother going to pick you up?
Yes.
Where is she?
We've always tried to teach our children to be very careful and particular about any strangers at anything.
I have always been concerned about the children, she says. The crisis of the murders will pass. But will things ever return to normal? Not quite.
I've had one or two children that would not even get in the car with me because they said my daddy told me not to get in the car, even though they know me.
A little girl was scared to even get on the bus.
Mothers like Joanne Ellison feel it.
She had, you know, thinking that maybe it might be the bus driver. You know, she didn't want to even ride the bus anymore.
Mothers like Ella Evans feel it.
It'll always be there. Every time you see a little kid, you'll always have that. It'll never disappear completely. How can it?
Atlanta has been the hub of the South. Some say the most livable place in America, the city too busy to hate. All that, and yet in its midst was an underclass, poor blacks whose children were being murdered.
Let's look at why this case was so important. Blacks die every day. Murders are committed every day.
Dr. Charles King heads the Urban Crisis Center.
And the only reason why this case has achieved such worldwide notoriety is the fact that it almost takes 28 dead blacks to equal the kind of public outrage of the killing of one well-respected white. And young blacks today have only three or four avenues to look at, football, basketball, or entertainment. Now, I blame society because giving them this lack of vision, the lack of projection, even Wayne Williams himself was searching for an identity.
And I've had people say to me, you know, we were really waiting to see how long it would take for blacks and whites in Atlanta to be at each other's throats.
Tom Hamill of the Atlanta Chamber of Commerce.
But I think the real key was the fact that the black and white in this town did really come together and stay together remarkably well and collaborated.
As far as bringing people together, I disagree. As a matter of fact, things are going on as usual. The city council, for instance, just cut the budget of the recreation department, where at the time of the murders, this was the hue and cry, we need more recreation, we need more places for children to go.
The funerals are over, the searches called off, the green ribbons people wore are gone. Gwendolyn Coleman is just as careful about the children as she ever was. But will things ever return fully to normal? Not quite.
I mean, it was so many kids, so many little kids. It never just disappeared. It never will with me, and I think any mother that loves their kid is going to always remember this sort of thing happening and that it could have happened to their kid, and it could also happen again.
This is Ned Potter.
Perhaps the terror of the Atlanta killings is that it did not have to be Atlanta. It could have happened anywhere and has happened elsewhere. Sometimes we mask the enormity of such crimes with code names. For example, in California, we call them the freeway killings. Code names to make short order sense of that which makes no sense. People who prey on the young for reasons known only to them. Yet there are reasons, not justification, but reasons. Jerry Bowen reports.
It was the summer of 1973 when the nation focused in horror on Houston and the unfolding story of a mass murderer and his teenaged accomplices. They claimed 27 victims, all teenaged boys, all sexually tortured before they were murdered. Chicago and the winter of 1978. A 37-year-old contractor confessed to killing 33 young men and boys. Most were buried beneath his house. Another case of sex and murder. The worst case on record, but not the last. In Los Angeles, where major crimes earn Hollywood titles, the freeway killings began in 1978. It was a three-year murder spree that ended with 23 known victims, mostly teenage boys whose bodies were discarded near freeways. Another case of sex, torture, and death.
The cases are chillingly similar in several respects, not the least of which the killers and their accomplices, and how little their families and friends really knew about them or wanted to know about them.
Elmer Wayne Henley, 17 years old at the time, became the main defendant in the Houston case after he killed 33-year-old Dean Correll in self-defense. Henley was convicted for murdering six of the boys.
Wayne would never kill anybody.
John Wayne Gacy, convicted in the Chicago case, liked to have his picture taken with celebrities and performed as a clown at birthday parties. To his neighbors, he was Mr. Nice Guy.
A very personable person and easy to get along with.
We, the jury, in the above entitled action, find the defendant, William George Bonin, guilty of murder.
William Bonin was convicted in 10 of the freeway killer cases. Bonin had a record as a sex offender. He liked to handcuff young boys. That much his mother knew before his arrest.
He would put it on them and do his act and then let them go. He never hurt them except for the handcuffs, which was bad enough.
Investigators, however, saw a different side of the mass murderer.
He thought that maybe society owed him this type of thing. He gave me the impression that the kids were out there for his choosing, you know, for him to just pick them up and do what he wanted to do.
And the victims in Houston and Chicago and Los Angeles, for the most part, young white males. What made them vulnerable? What makes any teenager vulnerable in this society?
Adolescence is a time often when the young person, in order to deal with reality, has to rather omnipotently say, it's not going to affect me, everybody else but not me.
I don't think in a lot of cases their parents know where they're going or know where they're at for long periods of time. If you've been out on Santa Monica Boulevard, you know that there's literally hundreds of kids out there, and I think it's kind of obvious that a lot of them are underage.
Every major city has its own Santa Monica Boulevard. It's a bustling Hollywood street, home to runaways, notorious for the young male prostitutes hustling tricks, an area where the freeway killer found at least two victims. But whether it's Houston, Chicago, or LA, the attitude of the young hustler is the same.
I mean, if someone is going to come across and say, okay, I want your money, I want some sex, and I'm going to kill you, and he shows me a gun or a knife or whatever, okay, then I'm going to hurt him with this, okay? I've hurt several people all day.
Everywhere you go, you're taking a chance.
That's it, go risk it, everything you do.
If you want to hustle, you have to take that risk.
You don't find kids that are star athletes down here. You don't find kids that are student body presidents. It's kids with some kind of major problems that they didn't handle very well.
16-year-old Stephen Wood was not a star athlete, but he wasn't a runaway or prostitute either. He was the kid who lives next door in Anywhere America, never gets into any real trouble, obeys his parents. But still, Stephen Wood became a victim of a mass murderer, the freeway killer, in April of 1980.
I said, Stephen, whatever you do, don't hitchhike. And he says, oh, Mom, there's a lot of weirdos out there. I'm not dumb enough to do that.
Houston, Chicago, Los Angeles, a common thread of tragedy. A story of young boys who grew up to be men, who killed young boys. A statement about American culture, perhaps.
Perhaps society failed to help the murderers and the murder victims alike in some necessary ways. Perhaps their families failed them, or they simply failed themselves. In all the cases, what can be said is that too little was known about the killers and many of their victims until it was too late. This is Jerry Bowen in Los Angeles.
This time, it happened in Atlanta. And the recently elected mayor of Atlanta, Andrew Young, was in Washington when the Williams verdict was announced this evening. Mayor Young is now in our CBS News Washington Bureau. Mayor, good evening. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you very much.
This vicious Dickensian world in which adults, for their own purposes, sometimes sexual, sometimes money, prey on young people who think they know more than they know. It happens in every big city, but you're the mayor of Atlanta. What are you going to do about it?
Well, basically, what we're trying to do about it is understand the life that our children live. And I think there's been a greater focus on our school system, particularly on the question of those who drop out. Many of the young people were in school, however, who were killed. And Wayne Williams himself was a very successful student through the high school years. In fact, I knew Wayne as a high school student. And it was not until late adolescence or after what seems to be failures in college that he seemed to fall apart. So it's pretty hard to know what we can do structurally in the society. Basically, we've got to make basic institutions like the family and give the kind of support that we can in a city through recreation, through basic support activities that come from the community.
But speaking of that support, Mayor, we heard earlier in this broadcast a charge that the City Council had just recently decided to reduce the amount of money it would be spending on summer recreation.
Well, one committee of the City Council did that, and I don't think that that will stand. In fact, I think some of those parks that were voted closed, we will be able to open and must open. It doesn't represent any policy on my part. It basically represents an attempt that all cities have of trying to cope with inflation and still deliver city services with less available money.
Mayor, what about the accusation made again tonight by Wayne Williams' father that this was a political trial? The federal government had hammered down hard on the authorities in Atlanta to get a man, and that they got Wayne Williams.
Well, what happened, I think, was one of the fairest trials that I've ever heard of. Both the police that investigated the case and the FBI officials were both black. The judge in the case, the defense attorney team was led by a young black attorney who I think did a very good job. The jury was 8 blacks and 4 whites, both defense and prosecution seemed to be satisfied with the jury during the 9 weeks of the trial. Mr. and Mrs. Williams seemed to be impressed with the way the trial went and offered no complaint. I think they're obviously upset at the verdict because it also is a verdict on them as parents. And I sympathize with them in this, but I don't think it's fair to second guess the 12 people who sat through this for 9.5 weeks and who listened to every shred of evidence and who saw the trial through from beginning to end. I think in one case, in our case in Atlanta, the newspapers, I think, bent over backwards being fair. They didn't try him in the press. If anything, they gave equal treatment and almost more headlines to defense testimony.
Thank you very much, Atlanta Mayor Andrew Young. Thank you for being with us this evening. Collectively, we knew them as victims of a child killer. The headlines about their deaths grew larger as the list of snatched and killed grew to 28. Sociologically, we knew them as the children of Atlanta's poor and black, in search of odd jobs and pocket money on the mean streets of a rundown neighborhood. There is some truth in that, but there is another truth. They lived and died one by one over a 22-month period. They were individuals, each a young life, with a name, a personality, a family circle, a circle of friends, and a neighborhood they called home. They were 28 of America's children.
Edward Smith, age 14. Alfred Evans, age 13. Milton Harvey, age 14. Yusuf Bell, age 9. Angel Lanier, age 12. Eric Middlebrooks, age 15. Aaron Weich, age 10. Anthony Carter, age 9. Clifford Jones, age 13. Charles Stevens, age 12. LaTanya Wilson, age 8. Aaron Jackson, age 9. Patrick Rogers, age 16. Christopher Richardson, age 11. Earl Terrell, age 10. Terry Pugh, age 15. Luby Jeter, age 14. Patrick Baltazar, age 11. Jeffrey Mathis, age 11. Curtis Walker, age 13. Timothy Hill, age 13. Eddie Duncan, age 21. Larry Rogers, age 21. Joseph Bell, age 15. Michael McIntosh, age 23. Jimmy Ray Payne, age 21. William Barrett, age 17. Nathaniel Cater, age 27.
No headline, no verdict can help us fully fathom why they died. Nor can any headline or verdict convey the pain of parents who have lived to bury their slain children. The rest of us are left with a verdict in Atlanta, with 28 children who came to symbolize one city's fear and every parent's nightmare. For CBS News, Dan Rather. Good night.
This has been a CBS News special report. Verdict in Atlanta.
There's a new chapter that has been opened in Atlanta's old horror story, the child murders case. 28 young blacks slain over a two-year period starting in 1979. Authorities say that the chain of terror ended with the arrest and the conviction of Wayne Williams. He was eventually convicted in two of those deaths. Well, now a team of lawyers is calling for a new trial for Williams. One of those attorneys is Bobby Lee Cook. He is joining us from our Atlanta Bureau. He tells us why they are doing this. Mr. Cook, let's see if we can narrow this down. It has to do with some evidence that the Georgia Bureau of Investigation was looking at that you, or I should say the defense team, never received.
That is correct, Forrest.
Tell me about the evidence.
Well, some of the evidence, of course, relates to an informant that was working for the Georgia Bureau of Investigation, who had reported, among other things, that there would be a killing per month of black children in the community. This evidence was suppressed. It was never, in fact, turned over to the court for an in-camera inspection by the judge. Apparently, a unilateral decision was made by what I would perceive to be overzealous investigators to suppress the evidence. Well, this was withheld from the defense and withheld from the court. This is only the tip of the iceberg.
Well, Mr. Cook, as you know, I was down there covering that story at the time, and it was a period when there were a lot of leads that were surfacing. There were more than 20 separate investigations on suspects that were led by the GBI that came to no end at all. The DeKalb County led a number of investigations that came to no end. In fact, some of the GBI say if you were, or the defense team, were to get all the material that was available, you'd have a warehouse full. They never turned it over to the prosecution, saying that it wasn't material to the case.
It was not a decision, in my opinion, for the GBI to make as not to turn it over to the prosecution. It indeed should have been submitted to the presiding judge, Judge Cooper, who in this particular case would have been required to make an in-camera inspection. And he, Judge Cooper, would have made the decision as to whether that evidence would have been exculpatory or helpful to the defense.
The heart of this material, as I understand it, goes to a threat that was made on the life of Luby Jeter, one of the young men who was finally killed, but Wayne Williams was not charged with his murder. Is it possible that the judge could rule, yes, the defense team should have received this material, but no, it is not particularly material to this case, and therefore the conviction stands?
We do not believe that the courts will rule in such a manner. If you undercut the pattern killings in this case, you really undercut the heart of the prosecution. You must bear in mind that although Mr. Williams was specifically charged in the indictment with only two killings, nevertheless, at the time of the trial, he was called upon to defend against 10 separate similar killings, which were indeed attributed to him. If you undercut the pattern evidence, particularly the Geter matter, then you underpin the strength of the state's case, and it crumbles, in my opinion.
Mr. Cook, have you gotten involved in this case because you are convinced of Mr. Williams' innocence, or is it because you are convinced that the trial was not fairly conducted?
Well, let me say this. When you say the trial was not fairly conducted, the point that I make is that Judge Cooper never had the opportunity to make a decision with reference to the evidence which we address in the habeas corpus petition. I am convinced that vital evidence was suppressed, and if the defense had this particular evidence, that the result of the trial indeed could and probably would have been different. This is one of the reasons that I am interested in the case. Moreover, I also have grave doubts from my review of documentary evidence in this case as to the guilt of Mr. Williams.
Your grave doubts center around the nature of the evidence that was presented, which is that much
the
publicized.
The nature of the evidence, the suppression of the evidence about which we are speaking now, together with the quality of the evidence. I was never overly impressed with the evidence relating to fibers.
But
this is very tenuous as far as I am concerned.
Finally, Mr. Cook, in this particular case and on this appeal, isn't it going to boil down to whether an appeals judge or an appeals court, however far you take it, agrees with you that this evidence is material to the conviction of Wayne Williams?
Absolutely. And let me say this, Forrest. I have absolute confidence in the integrity and the reliability of our courts in Georgia, and I am convinced that justice will be done in this case.
How far are you willing to carry it?
We're willing to carry it as far as it is necessary to go.
That means that you would carry it all the way to the Supreme Court?
That is correct.
Mr. Cook, there are some people who are on this case free of charge, and Alan Dershowitz of Harvard is one of them. Are you as well?
Yes, I am.
Why is that?
Well, I think there are times when one must not be concerned only with money. There are principles involved in this case. There are vital legal principles involved, and justice is at stake.
Well, we shall certainly follow it in the courts and see what they decide about it. Bobby Lee Cook, a well-known criminal attorney in Georgia, thank you for talking with us.
Thank you, Forrest.
It is now 17 minutes.
Convicted Atlanta child killer Wayne Williams could win a new trial if his lawyers can win their point with a Georgia judge. The defense team argues that the prosecution in the 1982 trial kept crucial evidence to itself. Aaron Hayes has our report.
Wayne Williams hopes a new trial would prove he was not Atlanta's child killer. He served almost 10 years for two of the killings, was linked by police to many of the others. Arrested after being seen with some of the victims and near the site where one body was found. In court, Williams' attorneys pushed for a new trial, saying the prosecution withheld key information at the first trial, that someone else might have been behind Atlanta's missing and murdered children. That someone else, they say, a member of the Ku Klux Klan. At this hearing, a police informant testified that 10 years ago, at the request of police, he recorded a Ku Klux Klan recruiter admitting taking part in one of the child killings.
I said he told me he was going to kill that little black guy out there.
But the police chief at the time testified he was unaware of Whitaker's information.
Yeah, and I don't recall anyone giving me any information that would suggest that there was Klan involvement.
Police have said they've lost track of the Ku Klux Klan recruiter, and they remain convinced they got the right man in the child killings. A decision about a new trial for Williams is not expected soon. More testimony is still to come at a date yet to be scheduled.
Aaron Hayes, this weekend's CBS March on Washington helped focus further attention on the problems of the big cities. In one of those cities, Atlanta, a major effort is getting underway to turn things around. That's tonight's Sunday Cover, a program that offers hope for a single city with two faces. For the rich, middle class, and employed, this is Atlanta. But for the underclass, jobless, and homeless, this is Atlanta.
I don't want to be out here, but you know, it's for the best right now. I don't have the funds to get an apartment.
This hut is home for Sharice Davis and her three-year-old son, Livingston. Almost half the city's population lives in extreme poverty. That means lack of food, medical care, employment, and social services.
I think the greatest discrimination in the world right now is among rich people against the poor people. And we rich people don't really understand the despair, the hopelessness, the sense of rejection. These problems have to be met.
And we go into the worst slum areas in the United States.
Former President Jimmy Carter is trying to meet the needs of the city's poor by launching the Atlanta Project. He hopes to mobilize up to 50,000 volunteers to go out into troubled neighborhoods to assist teachers and healthcare workers and law enforcement officials. His goal is to reverse the downward spiral of urban decay in neighborhoods like this one.
My Lord, the shower got holes all in it up in there. It don't make no sense. It's ridiculous.
For community leaders like Eva Davis, the lack of repair and despair have gone hand in hand for too long. She says she's watched her projects at East Lake Meadows deteriorate physically and mentally. She's seen children who deserve a better life grow up into drug dealers. Davis believes the Atlanta Project is long overdue.
It makes me feel really, really sad for one thing, and it makes me mad as hell for the next. They need to give us a group of people to work with us, hand to hand and side by side, and do some of the things that we are asking them to do.
Volunteers, government agencies, and local businesses are already responding to the cry for help and have signed up to assist Mr. Carter. But many in need say they have heard this sermon before and doubt that help and changes are really on the way.
I'm real skeptical, and I'm very much believing and seeing on this. I've heard a lot of talk and a lot of, oh, those poor people, but oh, those poor people, some of them used to be up there in the top.
Jimmy Carter hopes his Atlanta Project will help get the poor back up there by getting the rich together with the poor and by working together make the two Atlantas one.
That the people in Atlanta who are more affluent and who have more influence also join with them as equal partners, not as Santa Claus, in helping to make their lives better.
But somebody got to put in a hand, you know, somebody got to help. But it keep people like me from being on the streets.
On Wednesday, the Atlanta Project will launch a big fundraising campaign to add to the $26 million already committed.
Serial murder case from more than 20 years ago, the Atlanta child murders, is back in the news tonight. The only man convicted in the case has insisted all along he was innocent, and now, after all these years, police there are taking another look. Here's Jim Acosta with our report.
It was 1981. Atlanta was a city under siege. Over 2 years, 29 children and young men, all African American, were found murdered. A suspect, Wayne Williams, was eventually convicted.
Quite frankly, I don't think Wayne Williams is responsible for anything.
Now, local police chief Lewis Graham is reopening four of the cases, more than two decades after he was first assigned as an investigator to the killings.
I made my mind up with that over 20 years ago, and I still feel that way.
Williams was convicted in just two of the murders, but prosecutors blamed him for almost all of the rest, a fact he seized on in a recent jailhouse interview.
I think what you had was several groups of murders that happened during the same period. And the mistake the police and authorities made was by grouping these killings together and putting them all on a list and assuming you had a single killer.
I don't believe he did it.
Standing in Williams' corner are some of the victims' families. Willie Mae Mathis has received Christmas cards from Williams.
He said, "Miss Mathis said, I didn't have anything to do with those children's murder. Say, I never killed nobody."
Williams' lawyer accuses authorities of covering up evidence pointing to other suspects, including the KKK.
You have to understand the times, the racial complexion of the city at that time.
But a prosecutor in the original case says there was just too much forensic evidence linking Williams to the slangs.
This was like a puzzle, and we don't have all the pieces. We've got most of them.
It's unclear whether any new CSI technology that didn't exist a quarter century ago might unearth some new evidence. What is clear is that this cold case is just warming up. Jim Acosta, CBS News.
Investigation is reacting to the announcement that investigators are re-examining evidence in this case. Wayne Williams is in prison for murdering two adults, but that was he was never convicted for any of the child murders from 40 years ago. Channel 2's Steve Gelbach is live at City Hall in downtown Atlanta. Steve, you spoke with Williams' advocates who say this is a chance for him to clear his name.
Sophia, they're from the Wayne Williams Freedom Project, spoke to them here during a news conference, and they say Williams, now 60 years old, serving life sentence in prison, has always maintained his innocence and welcomes this re-examination of the case and re-looking at evidence and appreciates the mayor's actions here. Along with the APD, Fulton County DA, and the GBI, the city's going to take another look at these unsolved child murders from 1979 through 81 and retest stored evidence. Although never convicted, they have said evidence does link Wayne Williams to many of the murdered children. Those representing Williams today, though, said they've been doing their own investigation with a private investigator for the past 10 months. They call the carpet fiber evidence that convicted him in the two murders of the young adults fabricated. They hope reexamination not only exonerates him, but finds the real killer or killers. This is part of the letter, a statement read from Williams in prison.
I just hope that not only will some answers come forth as far as the suspects and other persons who are responsible for these terrible crimes, but I also hope that we can get to the bottom of the social conditions that led to this type of apathy in Atlanta.
And I also heard from a family member of one of those young victims, Jeffrey Mathis. He was victim number 5 in the child murders. He does not believe this cousin, that Wayne Williams, is responsible. Hear from him about what they say those results of their own investigation will also reveal here coming up on Channel 2 Action News starting at 4 p.m.
There's a serial killer going around, a major wacko. However, he ain't like your usual limp-ass serial killer type of freckle-headed hitchhiker on a highway. No, this guy, he's got a little bit more integrity. This serial killer.
Serial killer.
Serial killer, huh? Do you know what we call two murders here? The morning shift.
Look. You see how her mouth was manipulated? We think his was too. and there was no forced entry in either case. And Ullman's body was just a few miles over the jurisdictional line.
And?
Well, so he's spreading his targets far enough apart, and he's changing the profile of the victim so that we don't connect them.
Serial killers leave calling cards. They want the world to know what they're doing.
I'm telling you, I know that this is the same guy.
You know nothing. You are guessing, and you want me to give you manpower to follow a hunch.
All I need is one detective with profiling experience.
You know, if I knew that sending it to Chamberlain was going to trigger this, I would have sent somebody who was better equipped. But as I said, I don't have anybody else.
There are two great fears haunting this nation. White people fear something they call black extremism. Black people fear something they call white racism. The balance of this broadcast addresses itself to these two fears and to some common ground we found between the races. We're going to measure white racism first, black extremism second, and then we'll talk about some hopeful signs in the common ground.